Topic 7. Risk Management, Controlling Risk. Introduction to Risk Control. An organization must choose one of five basic strategies to control risks. Defense means applying safeguards that eliminate or reduce the remaining uncontrolled risk. Transference means shifting risks to other areas or to outside entities. Mitigation means reducing the impact to information assets should an attacker successfully exploit a vulnerability. Acceptance means understanding the consequences of choosing to leave a risk uncontrolled and then properly acknowledging the risk that remains without an attempt at control. And finally, termination, removing or discontinuing the information asset from the organization's operating environment. The defense risk control strategy attempts to prevent the exploitation of the vulnerability. This is the preferred approach and is accomplished by means of countering threats, removing vulnerabilities and assets, limiting access to assets, and adding protective safeguards. This approach is sometimes referred to as avoidance. Three common methods of risk defense are application of policy, application of training and education, and implementation of technology. The transference risk control strategy attempts to shift risk to another entity. This goal may be accomplished by rethinking how services are offered, revising deployment models, outsourcing to other organizations, purchasing insurance, or implementing service contracts with providers. When an organization does not have adequate security management and administration experience, it should hire individuals or firms that provide expertise in those areas. This is outsourcing. The key to an effective transference risk control strategy is the implementation of an effective service level agreement. In some circumstances, an SLA is the only guarantee that an external organization will implement the level of security the client organization wants. The FDIC also suggests that organizations use the following four steps to create a successful SLA: determining objectives, defining requirements, setting measurements, and establishing accountability. The mitigation risk control strategy is the control approach that attempts to reduce, by means of planning and preparation, the damage caused by a realized incident or disaster. This approach includes three types of plans: a disaster recovery plan, an incident response plan, a business continuity plan. Mitigation depends upon the ability to detect and respond to an attack as quickly as possible. This slide shows a summary of the various types of mitigation plan. We will discuss these more in a later topic. The acceptance risk control strategy is the decision to do nothing to protect an information asset from risk and to accept the outcome from any resulting exploitation. It may or may not be a conscious business decision. Unconscious acceptance of risk is not a valid approach to risk control. An organization that decides on acceptance as a strategy for every identified risk of loss may in fact be unable to conduct proactive security activities and may have an apathetic approach to security in general. Acceptance is recognized as a valid strategy only when the organization has determined the level of risk posed to the information asset, assessed the probability of attack and the likelihood of a successful exploitation of a vulnerability, estimated the potential damage or loss that could result from attacks, evaluated potential controls using each appropriate type of feasibility, performed a thorough risk assessment including a financial analysis such as a CBA, and determined that the cost to control the risk to a particular function, service, collection of data, or information asset do not justify the cost of implementing and maintaining the controls. Like acceptance, the termination risk management strategy is based on the organization's need or choice not to protect an asset. Here, however, the organization does not wish the information asset to remain at risk and so removes it from the environment that represents risk. The cost of protecting an asset may outweigh its value, or it may be too difficult or expensive to protect an asset compared to the value or advantage that asset offers the company. In either case, termination must be a conscious business decision, not simply the abandonment of an asset, which would technically qualify as acceptance. Risk appetite, also known as risk tolerance, is the quantity and nature of risk that organizations are willing to accept as they evaluate the trade-offs between perfect security and unlimited accessibility. The reasoned approach to risk is one that balances the expense in terms of finance and the usability of information assets against the possible losses if exploited. When vulnerabilities have been controlled to the degree possible, there is often remaining risk that has not been completely removed, shifted, or planned for. In other words, residual risk. Residual risk is the amount of risk that remains after the organization has implemented policy, education and training, and technical controls and safeguards. The goal of information security is not to bring residual risk to zero. Rather, it is to bring it in line with an organization's risk appetite. If decision makers have been informed of uncontrolled risks and the proper authority groups within the communities of interest decide to leave residual risk in place, then the information security program has accomplished its primary goal. A few rules of thumb for selecting a strategy. When a vulnerability exists in an important asset, implement security controls to reduce the likelihood of a vulnerability being exploited. When a vulnerability can be exploited, apply layered protections, architectural designs, and administrative controls to minimize the risk or prevent the occurrence of an attack. When the attacker's potential gain is greater than the cost of attack, apply protections to increase the attacker's cost or reduce the attacker's gain by using technical or managerial controls. When the potential loss is substantial, apply design principles, architectural designs, and technical and non-technical protections to limit the extent of the attack, thereby reducing the potential for loss. This slide shows a number of the action points in the risk handling process. Once a control strategy has been selected and implemented, control should be monitored and measured on an ongoing basis to determine their effectiveness and to maintain an ongoing estimate of the remaining risk. At a minimum, each information asset threat pair that was developed in the risk assessment created previously should have a documented control strategy that clearly identifies any residual risk that remains after the proposed strategy has been executed. This slide illustrates the risk control cycle. Before deciding on the strategy for a specific asset vulnerability threat combination, all readily accessible information about the consequences of the vulnerability must be explored. What are the actual and perceived advantages of implementing a control as opposed to the actual and perceived disadvantages? While the advantages of a specific strategy can be identified in a number of ways, The primary way is to determine the value of the information asset it is designed to protect. Cost avoidance is the money saved by using the defense strategy via the implementation of a control, thus eliminating the financial ramifications of an incident. The criterion most commonly used when evaluating a project that implements information security controls and safeguards is economic feasibility. Organizations can begin this type of economic feasibility analysis by valuing the information assets and determining the loss in value if those information assets become compromised. The decision-making process is called a cost-benefit analysis or an economic feasibility study. Just as it is difficult to determine the value of information, it is difficult to determine the cost of safeguarding it. Some of the items that affect the cost of a control or safeguard include the cost of development or acquisition of hardware, software, and services, training fees, cost of implementation, service costs, and costs of maintenance. Benefit is the value to the organization of using controls to prevent losses associated with a specific vulnerability. The benefit is usually determined by valuing the information asset or assets exposed by the vulnerability, and then determining how much of that value is at risk and how much risk there is for that asset. This is expressed as the annualized loss expectancy. Asset valuation is the process of assigning financial value or worth to each information asset. The value of information differs within and between organizations. Asset valuation involves the estimation of real and perceived costs, which can be selected from those associated with the design, development, installation, maintenance, protection, recovery, and defense against loss or litigation. Some of the components of asset valuation include value retained from the cost of creating the information asset, value retained from past maintenance of the information asset, value implied by the cost of replacing the information, value from providing the information, value acquired from the cost of protecting the information, value to owners, value of intellectual property, value to adversaries, loss of productivity while the information assets are unavailable, and loss of revenue while information assets are unavailable. Once an organization has estimated the worth of various assets, it can begin to calculate the potential loss from the successful exploitation of vulnerability. This calculation yields an estimate of potential loss per risk. The questions that must be asked include, what damage would occur and what financial impact would it have? What would it cost to recover from the attack in addition to the financial impact of the damage? What is the single loss expectancy for each risk? A single loss expectancy, or SLE, is the calculated value associated with the most likely loss from a single occurrence of a specific attack. It takes into account both the value of the asset and the expected percentage of loss that would occur from a particular attack. The SLE equals the asset value times the exposure factor, where the exposure factor is the percentage loss that would occur from a given vulnerability being exploited. This information is usually estimated. Usually, the probability of a threat occurring is depicted as a table that indicates how frequently an attack from each threat type is likely to occur within a given time frame. This value is commonly referred to as the annualized rate of occurrence, or ARO. The ARO simply indicates how often you expect a particular type of attack to occur. Once you determine the loss from a single attack, and the likely frequency of successful attacks, you can calculate the overall loss potential per risk expressed as an annualized loss expectancy using the previous values for the ARO and SLE. The cost-benefit analysis determines whether the benefit from a control alternative is worth the associated cost of implementing and maintaining the control. A CBA may be performed before implementing a control or safeguard, or they can be performed after controls have been in place for a while. In the formula, the CBA equals the pre-control annualized loss expectancy minus the post-control annualized loss expectancy minus the annual cost of the safeguard itself. Organizational feasibility analysis examines how well the proposed information security alternatives will contribute to efficiency, effectiveness, and overall operation of an organization. Operational feasibility refers to user acceptance and support, management acceptance and support, and the system's compatibility with the requirements of the organization's stakeholders. User acceptance and support can be achieved by means of communication, education, and involvement. Technical feasibility determines whether or not the organization has or can acquire the technology and expertise to implement, support, and manage the new safeguards. Political feasibility defines what can and cannot occur based on the consensus and relationships between the communities of interest, especially given that the budget allocation decisions can be politically charged. Some alternatives to feasibility analysis include benchmarking, due care and due diligence, best business practices, the gold standard, government recommendations and best practices such as those from NIST, and using a baseline.